I would once again request everyone to be seated so we can commence with the program. Honorable Excellencies, delegates, and representatives from foreign and domestic institutions, distinguished speakers, professors and scholars, guests, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the organizer, Center for Social Inclusion and Federalism, we wish to extend our warm welcome to you for your participation in today's event. It's my pleasure to be an MC for today's program, discussing Kathmandu Dilemma, Resetting India-Nepal Ties. Center for Social Inclusion and Federalism, Nepal, is a not-for-profit, autonomous and independent private research institution serving the public interest with significant independence from any donor or interest group and autonomy from the government. Center for Social Inclusion and Federalism provides non-partisan independent analysis and inputs on the matter of economy and development, domestic politics and governance, national security and climate change, international relations and foreign affairs, gender and social inclusion, and federal affairs. Our primary mandate is to facilitate civic participation in policy making and conduct in-depth research, provide qualitative and quantitative analysis, and invest in tomorrow's leading researchers today. My name is Shraddha Gimire, and I'm associated with Center for Social Inclusion and Federalism within the capacity of a junior research fellow working under the thematic area Economy and Development. We are honored to have an esteemed group of participants and speakers. To begin with, I would like to introduce our chief guest for today. Former Prime Minister Pushpa Kamal Dahal Prachanda led the country as Prime Minister two times. After receiving his early education at Kaski, he completed his Bachelor's in Science in Agriculture from the Institute of Agriculture and Animal Sciences in Chitwan. Dahal became the General Secretary of CPN Maoist in 1995. Soon in 2000, he was elevated to the position of party president, followed by the Supreme Commander of the People's Liberation Party in 2001. In 2006, alongside Prime Minister Girija Prasad Koirala, Dahal signed the historic Comprehensive Peace Accord and also worked towards drafting of the new constitution. Under his leadership, CPN Maoist became the single largest party in the Constituent Assembly in 2008, making him the first Prime Minister of Democratic Nepal. In August 2016, Dahal was elected as Prime Minister again by the Constituent Assembly with the support of Madheshi Front and the Nepali Congress. Dahal currently is the chairperson of CPN Maoist and is an integral part of the five-party coalition government under the premiership of Sher Bahadur Deuba. I would now like to request all our speakers to come to the stage. Ambassador Ranjit Ray, Professor Lokraj Baral, Amish Raj Mulmi, Ms. Apeksha Shah, and Professor Vijaykant Karna. Thank you, speakers. Moving ahead with the introduction, I would now like to introduce Ambassador Ranjit Ray. Ambassador Ray is a former member of the UN Advisory Committee on Administrative and Budgetary Questions and also served as a representative of the UN General Embassy on the UN Joint Staff Pension Fund. He has worked as a staff member in the United Nations Mission in Kosovo and in the Department of Peacekeeping Operations in New York. Ambassador Ray has also held important positions in the Indian government. Prior to retirement in 2017, Ambassador Ray had served as India's ambassador to Hungary with concurrent accreditation to Slovenia, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Vietnam and Nepal. Ambassador Ray has a master's degree from the Delhi School of Economics and worked as a lecturer at St. Stephen's College before joining the Indian Foreign Service in 1980. He has recently published his first book, Kathmandu Dilemma, Resetting India-Nepal Ties. Moving on to our next speaker, Dr. Lokraj Baral is a professor of political science and former ambassador of Nepal to India. Professor Baral was visiting professor at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign and visiting fellow at CHR Michelsen Institute at Bergen, Norway. Professor Baral has 25 books, both authored and edited, and has published articles in leading international journals, including The Asian Survey, Pacific Affairs, Pacific Community, Journal of Democracy, and others. He has lectured at MIT, Oxford, University of Heidelberg, UCLA, City University of New York, just to mention a few. Amish Raj Mulmi is the author of All Roads Lead North, Nepal's Turn to China. His writings have been published in the Himalayan Arc, Journeys of East, of Southeast, and West Asian Speculative Fiction. He has written for, among others, Al Jazeera, Roads and Kingdoms, Himal South Asia, India Today, The Kathmandu Post, and The Record. He is consulting editor at Writer's Side Literary Agency and has previously worked for Juggernaut Books and Hachette India. Ms. Apeksha Shah is an assistant professor at the Department of International Relations and Diplomacy at Tribhuvan University. She holds a postgraduate degree in diplomacy and foreign policy from City, University of London, and a bachelor's degree in political science from Delhi University. Her main areas of research include diplomacy, foreign policy, and public policy. Professor Vishikant Karna is a former ambassador of Nepal to Denmark and professor of political science at Tribhuvan University. He is currently the executive chairperson of Center for Social Inclusion and Federalism. Now moving ahead to the schedule of the program, I would here like to inform you all that the program would commence with the speakers and the discussion, followed by a small informal discussion with the audience and participants while enjoying the refreshments. I would kindly remind all our speakers today of their time limit of 15 minutes so we can run according to the schedule. I would now like to hand over the discussion to Professor Vishikant Karna for his moderation. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Sardar. I would like to welcome you all and all the panelists. We have esteemed guest here, former Prime Minister, former Ambassador to Nepal from India. We have my guru, Professor Lokaraj Baral, a Scot and still teaching me. And we have two young scholars with us, Ms. Apeksha Shah and the writer who has written recently a book called All Road to China, Amish Mulmi. So I would like to thank you all for this gathering, and just to begin with, I would like to tell one important issue that how this program is being organized. I would like to tell you everyone. Professor Baral was in 3 weeks back, was in Delhi for some personal reason. And he participated in the discussion with Mr. Ranjit Rai book, and we discussed and decided to invite him. So I have invited Mr. Ranjit Rai to Kathmandu, and he was kindly accepted our invitation to hear. So thank you, Ambassador, for coming from Delhi to Kathmandu. So now I would like Mr. Ranjit Rai, since we are discussing his book, so I would like to Ambassador to speak on his book, and then we will speak later. So Ambassador, right. Would like to hear, or yeah, whatever you say. You like to go.
Namaste, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, Prime Minister Prachand, Chairman of the Center for Social Inclusion and Federalism, Ambassador Vishikant Karna, Professor Lokaraj Baral, Amish Mulmi, and Apeksha Shah, and distinguished participants, luminaries. I see many, many friends in the audience. A very warm namaste to all of you. And it's always such a pleasure to be in Nepal. And the pleasure is all the more because today we have in our midst someone who is a symbol of all the seminal transformations that have taken place in Nepal in the last 2 to 3 decades. The transformations that have taken place in Nepal in other countries have taken hundreds of years, whereas in Nepal, these transitions are being undertaken almost simultaneously. So you can imagine how complex the task is. And I think the main protagonist in these transitions, in these transformations, is Prime Minister Prachand. So, sir, I am very grateful that you have agreed to participate in this book discussion. And of course, there are many elements of the book where I think you play a very, very important role. I don't want to say much about the book. I'm sure some of you will have read it and will form your own views. But I do want to say why I wrote it. A couple of reasons. One, you know, I'm passionately interested in the India-Nepal relationship, and I really feel that the relationship is suboptimal, that there is such a huge potential that is waiting to be exploited. Second, our relationship is very complex. Because it is such an intimate relationship, problems arise from time to time. There are frictions, there are misunderstandings, there are misperceptions. So I wanted to inform the public, both in Nepal and India, about the complexities of this relationship, about the psychology of this relationship. And my feeling was that it's very important to keep this in mind while working to strengthen and promote India-Nepal relationship. To just give you an instance, in India, we are very fond of talking about bhai bhai ka rishta. We are very fond of talking about a special relationship, not realizing that these are very sensitive issues in Nepal, and Nepal doesn't see it like that. In Nepal, you always talk about a balanced relationship of Nepal. And India, the question then arises, is the relationship very unbalanced? And if it is unbalanced, how will you balance it? And what will the implications of the new balance be in terms of India-Nepal relationship? So I think, you know, the idiom that we use in talking about our relationship becomes very important. And I think it's very important to understand each other's perspective, because that is the only way to go forward. The third element of the relationship, I think, and this is looking to the future. You know, there is such a lot of historical baggage in the relationship. After all, it's such a close relationship over hundreds of years. There's bound to be a lot of baggage. So how do we look forward? You know, we talk a lot about the civilizational links, the cultural links, and these are very strong, the people-to-people links. This is the foundation of the relationship. But how do we build on this foundation at a time when such major transformative changes are taking place worldwide? The geopolitics of our world is different today. The technology is different. The world is very different. So, you know, the aspirations of the young people of our societies are different. So how do we mold our relationship taking into account these major developments? And this is where I personally feel that we have to now base our relationship not just on the cultural aspect, but really it is the economic foundations that we really need to dig very deep. And when I talk about economic foundations, I think we have to develop our region or our sub-region as a common, interconnected, interdependent economic space where every participant benefits from the collective growth of the region. So we have to create the conditions under which this can happen, through connectivity, through exchanges, through development of hydropower, through development of regional supply chains. So I think this is really the direction in which we have to go. Just one or two more points I wanted to mention. many of my Nepalese friends, and I've received a lot of comments, I'm really overwhelmed by the interest. So many of them have said, why have you called it Kathmandu dilemma? It's really Delhi dilemma. So they have a point, it's actually Delhi's Kathmandu dilemma. And what is this dilemma that we have when dealing with Nepal? So the dilemma is we have multiple objectives that, you know, on the security side, on the development side, there's always this issue of the northern neighbor of Nepal. So many objectives. And you pursue a certain policy to achieve each of these objectives. And sometimes the strategies that you pursue tend to collide and create a conflict between various objectives. So, you know, your first objective, you try and do something, but then it leads to problems vis-a-vis your second or your third objective. So there's a reassessment, a review. So this is the way, the dynamic way in which foreign policy is made. And I've tried to give the readers a grasp or, you know, some instances of how decision making takes place in India and the kind of engagement and interaction that happens and how different points of views, you know, are on the basis of these views, you try and arrive at some common policy. So that's why Kathmandu dilemma. And the last point, you know, I'm quite proud of the cover of the book. And I have mentioned a little bit about it in the preface. So, you know, what I wanted to show is that it's a very nuanced relationship. So you have clouds of various colors from light, you know, white, bluish to darker grays. So that tends to reflect the state of the relationship. And of course, we'd like to have a cloudless relationship. How do we achieve it? Secondly, the mountain pass and the Chauhtans, you know, represent, you know, if I'm fond of trekking and I've trekked in your beautiful country as well. So when you reach a pass, there is a sense of achievement. It's a landmark, you know, milestone that you've achieved. And then you transit to the next phase of your journey. So I think that is what I'm trying to depict in terms of the major transitions that Nepal is undergoing and how these impact on the India-Nepal relationship. And of course, you have the Himalayas. And you know, the Himalayas of today are very different from the Himalayas of yesteryear. Actually, you know, people say Himalayas have been sort of, you know, the massif has been a boundary, a frontier, but actually there's, you know, for centuries and centuries, there's been a lot of trade. Buddhism has traveled across the Himalayas. So there has been very strong interaction. And, you know, Amish, of course, has written beautifully about the engagement of Nepal, you know, with her northern neighbor. And I think this is also a factor in the overall India-Nepal relationship, more so now, perhaps, than in the past. So, you know, that was what I had in mind, you know, when looking at the cover. So I want this book to be seen as a forward-looking book. You know, I don't want our relationship to be mired in the past. I think our people demand that we look to the future. And how do we prepare grounds, you know, for a very strong, mutually beneficial relationship in the future? And I've given some pointers. Of course, I've also discussed some of the sensitive issues in the relationship. But I think that my objective is, how do we move ahead? And I'm a free person now. I don't represent the government of India, so I have the liberty to express my views. Not that I didn't earlier, but I think I have a certain, you know, greater freedom now, which I have exercised in the book. And I hope some of you will find interest, you know, in the book. And I hope this leads to, you know, better understanding, at least between the peoples of our two countries. Thank you. And once again, I want to thank Ambassador Vijayakant Kan for having organized this event and for having invited me. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. It's very nice that we have Mr. Ranjit Rao, who was just 4 years back, was based in Kathmandu. And we have another writer. Mr. Rai wrote about the Nepal-India relations. We have another writer who wrote about Nepal-China relations. So we have another writer where the book is very popular and very, just 1 year, right? 1 year back he wrote a book or wrote to China. So I would like to request Amis Mulmizi to speak on the book. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. Thank former Prime Minister, former Ambassador, and my colleagues. Thank you so much for providing me this opportunity to talk about this book, which I think is important, timely, relevant, and most importantly, I think it is one of the most deeply engaged books on Nepal by an Indian diplomat, which is a rare feat. It is obviously rare for former diplomats to analyze and engage with Nepal once they're out of office, but even rarer when it's in book form. And it's quite evident that Ambassador Rai has engaged very, very widely when he was in office here, as well as after being in office. You can see by the gamut of issues that he raises and the few forward-looking sort of ideas that he presents. Some thoughts. We know that the India-Nepal relationship is a special relationship, and it's not just because how it's defined, but also because how it's structured in terms of the border, in terms of how peoples from both countries move across each other. But it is also increasingly evident that there are foundational shortcomings, and these shortcomings are being realized on both sides. It's not just let's say on the Kathmandu side, but it's also Delhi that's been talking about it. And it's quite unique because it seems as if there is a sort of constituency here where to even acknowledge the fact that this is a special relationship is a difficult one, and we've seen that in recent times. And this is why this book is even that much more important. It tells us why this relationship is special. It takes us to the intricacies of how the India-Nepal relationship shaped, how the borders function, how we, the peoples of two countries interact with each other. But most importantly, I think it tells us a path for the future. You know, you, as Ambassador said, you can keep being stuck in the past, but ultimately it is the future that beckons to us. And I think that is the most important part of this book, that Nepal's fact, the fact of geography and our intimate ties with India mean that we have to forge a future ahead with India. And this book tells us a certain sort of ways. We may take it up, we may not take it up, but there are certainly solutions in this book. And of course, like I said, there are issues, but we need solutions. We can keep harping on those issues, we can keep talking about the issues, but someday or the other, we will have to come up with solutions. So this book does that. The one thing that, personally speaking, in my view, the bilateral ties, it doesn't matter whether it's India and Nepal or Nepal and China, bilateral ties cannot remain politically expedient, which means that in India's case, in Nepal, anti-Indianism becomes a form of political capital that has to stop. At the same time, we need greater clarity on what Delhi requires or wants from the neighborhood, from the South Asian neighborhood. We understand that India's pluralism, India's diversity is its strength, and the other South Asian countries will definitely look up to that. In recent years, we've seen an Indian focus on connectivity, which has been excellent. But at the same time, we've also seen weaknesses on the Nepali side to execute that. The most recent example being the railway, the transfer of the Jayanagar-Kotha railway, where we've got the trains, we've got the lines, but we've just not got the laws to start operating the trains. At the same time, I think India also needs to start understanding that the Nepali population is one that consists of the youth. A major section of the Nepali population is today under 40. And what are their aspirations? What are their wants for the future? What are their requirements for the future? I think India definitely needs to understand that. The Indian economy has to be better linked to the Nepali economy. On this, obviously, Nepal has to have better FDI laws, better copyright protection laws. But at the same time, it's very interesting. There was a report I read recently that The Indian FDI in the last year has actually been growing faster in Nepal than China's, although the scale of China's is still higher. And at the same time, India has to utilize what is its most important weapon in diplomacy, which is its soft power. One simple example that I can give you here is that if India, let's say, focuses on cricket diplomacy, a term that I like to use a lot, but say that India starts supporting cricket development here in Nepal, grassroots cricket development here in Nepal, I think that will also shape, allow better perceptions of India to be shaped. Finally, I think that this relationship is something that has to go beyond personal relationships alone. A lot of India-Nepal ties, when we talk about it from the basic, on the basis of personal relationships between leaders, between officials. But I think there have to be achievable goals, there have to be achievable policy objectives that have to be clearly defined. What does Nepal want from India? And similarly, what does India want from Nepal? Until and unless we don't ideate these things, until and unless we don't clarify these things, we will have these issues that are constantly there, and they'll pop up every now and then. So if we need to resolve those, we need to start looking at solutions and not be stuck in the past. So I think that's about it. Thank you so much, once again.
Thank you, obviously. You rightly pointed out that we have to look forward, and for the past baggage, we have to go through the past baggage and look forward in the trade, in the economic relations, as well as the other strategic and geopolitical issues. Thank you, obviously. Now, I would like to request Apeksha Shah to speak up.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Apeksha, and it's an honor to be able to put forward my thoughts in front of such distinguished panelists today. And I would like to extend my gratitude to Sessa for having me over. First, I would like to congratulate Ambassador Ray on his book. Congratulations, sir. I had a really good time reading your book. For someone who studies interstate relations, such frank conversations are a gold mine of information to understand the gravitas and complexities of diplomacy and the role of a diplomat. The need for dialogue, consultation, and where necessary, collaboration between states is the bedrock of all diplomatic practices. In this course, the framework in which diplomacy operates varies from situation to situation on the basis of common understanding and occurs mostly behind closed doors, given the sensitive nature of the interaction. So personal memoirs of diplomats are bound to have a wider implication when such informations are shared. A lot has already been said on the book and by our previous speaker on Nepal-India relations. So I would just like to put forward a few points. Ambassador Ray has effectively summarized the complex and intimate relations the two countries share, while his accounts of his experience help us to understand the Indian perception towards Nepal. His recommendations for strengthening Nepal-India ties are very timely. His emphasis that India needs to develop an overreaching economic vision to reinforce Nepal-India relation, as well as linking that to larger regional initiatives such as BBIN or BIMSTEC, is an important takeaway. As a developing landlocked country, Nepal naturally sees its growth attuned to the rise of its neighbors, particularly India, given the nature of arrangements between the two economies and the geography. Poor implementation of India-backed development projects, failure of SAARC in promoting economic growth, and untapped hydropower capacities of Nepal has been detrimental to Nepal's economic aspirations. Trilateral cooperation on water and energy issues, as suggested by Ambassador, between Nepal, India, and Bangladesh is definitely overdue, especially for Nepal, as the two countries are the only viable market for its surplus energy. It is a matter of concern of Nepal that despite producing surplus power, it has not been able to export it. As Ambassador Ray rightly acknowledges in his book, India needs to work towards ensuring that its neighbors benefit from India's economic growth for the relations to be mutually beneficial. It is important for the Indian establishment to concentrate the energy to this end. In the past, leveraging India's unparalleled clout to meet political ends have raised anti-Indian sentiments among Nepalis across generations. Similarly, the ambassador also mentions the growing anti-Indian sentiments among younger generation of Nepal, which should make India assess its policies and impact state actions have in today's media age. particularly given the increased role of media and social media between the two countries. There is need to be cautious of the impact non-state actors have begun to play in diplomatic relations. The role of Indian media in aiding anti-Nepal sentiments has been an unprecedented episode that the ambassador mentions in his book. The people-to-people ties and the social-cultural link that bind the two countries are the strength of Nepal-India ties, which needs to be preserved and cherished. Nepal's other foreign policy goals should be viewed in respect to its development and growth aspirations. Nepal has always adhered to the policy of peaceful existence and endorses a policy of equitable relationship with its both neighbors. It is important to understand Nepal's interests and policies in the light of the sheer asymmetry it faces with both its neighbors, its landlocked geography, and the complexities in Indo-Sino ties. Nepal-India relations have gone through turbulent times in recent past, and failure to resolve the conflicting issues through diplomatic dialogue has led to hardening of positions post-2015. Conflicts of interest are bound to exist in all relations, more so in the case of Nepal and India, given the multidimensional relations the two countries share. But in any valued relationship, it is important to look beyond conflicting positions to understanding the interests of others that drive their behavior. The border working group established between the two countries has been looking into the unresolved issue of the disputed territories of Kalapani and Susta, while the high-level EPG group submitted its report on various contending issues between the two countries, including the 1950 treaty. Uninterrupted diplomatic dialogue is crucial for Nepal-India ties, as continuous exchange of ideas and the attempts to find mutually acceptable solutions to conflicting interests increase the awareness and respect of the issues. Having said that, in view of recent events, amicable solution to the existing conflicts should be found in a timely manner. I would like to conclude by acknowledging that Nepal's negotiations have suffered at all fronts, given decades of political instability in the country. And as India knows, things are complicated in a democracy. However, given the asymmetry between the two countries, the moral as well as prudential responsibility to find an acceptable compromise should fall on India as the larger partner. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Becha, for your very nice presentation. Now I would like to request Professor Parra, with my teacher at the university, who has been reading a lot of books, and he was former ambassador of Nepal to India as well.
Thank you, Abhijay, for inviting me to talk about the book written by Ambassador Ranjit Ray. Sometimes I am reminded of my old friend, Dr. Harka Gurung. When he used to address such gathering, and you used to look around the audience, the composition of the audience, and he used to say that no one is foreigners here, everybody is a Nepali. What should I speak in English? Then he used to speak in Nepali. I try to manage in English also. I interact with many Nepalese. And I knew him in 2002 in New Delhi when he was joint secretary. At the 2004 sometime. Then we were invited by the government of India as ambassadors Mukherjee, Shiv Shankar Mukherjee was here. And 6-7 persons were there. Dr. Prayara Sharma, myself, Bairagi Kaila, and many others. And he was the person there, and he organized a huge meeting in Indian Council of World Affairs. And Rajaman was on the chair, and I had to speak on India-Nepal relations. I also remember what Socrates said long ago about, and I try to link it up with India-Nepal relations. Socrates said, "I knew nothing, but I knew nothing." When I was ambassador in India, I was invited to give lectures in some universities, some places. Then I used to think that, though I have been working on this subject for the last 50 years, written 25, 30 books, and I am in Dhapali, very close to India, Siliguri, and I travel from Naxalpari, Galgalia to Jogbani, Raksol, I can count all stations from Siliguri to Raksol. That is my orientation. I knew India from my childhood. Across the Mechi River, there is Naxalwadi hut. Every Saturday, we used to go to Naxalwadi for shopping. But these days, we don't need to go because we have a lot of developments here inside the country. That's why, if you try to look at things from that perspective, how you know India? Sometimes we used to travel by train, other times there are no provision for reservation. You used to, you know, struggle for getting into the train. And some people used to, you know, oh, this Pahadi, some Indian poor people, they didn't know anything about these things. Oh, you are from Pahadi, you are a Pahadi. Our friends used to be offended. That happens in day-to-day life. But that doesn't mean that we should try to be anti-Indian by virtue of being, you know, in contact with different types of people. That's why India-Nepal relation is very close, wide-ranging, deep, and it is very difficult to understand. I never claim myself as an expert on India-Nepal relation. That's why I try to cite Socrates said, I knew nothing, but I knew nothing. I can understand something. It is so deep, so wide-ranging, so, you know, multifarious relationship. It's very difficult to claim oneself as an expert. And I don't never claim, but I always try to learn. And now, sometimes we feel that we have certain inherited mindset. I always use that word. In our side also, we have inherited mindset. We have not been able to overcome our psyche. Similarly, the Indian side, they have their own tradition, the old British Raj traditions and the bureaucracy. Even if the politician try to do something, sometimes the bureaucrats, we assume that they try to advise different things. It has happened. I'm reminded of Prime Minister Modi's speech in our parliament, in the Constitutional Assembly. And he tried a very good atmosphere, as if India-Nepal relationship was going to be transformed from this stage to another stage. We thought that now a new era has begun. But suddenly, that didn't happen after some time. That's why they have their own calculations and what went wrong, we don't know. Some misunderstanding again when we were drafting the constitutions. And Ambassador Ray has tried to put things in perspective when Jaishankar visited Nepal. There is a feeling in Nepal that Jaishankar was much more aggressive and assertive and dominant. And Prachandji here, he knows much about it because he is also the actor. And Ambassador Ray was also an actor. We are the outsiders. But he has tried to clarify the situations about it. Sometimes some misunderstanding happens. Jaishankar, so aggressive, so assertive, so dominant. That is the kind of idea, you know, spirit in Nepal. And he has come out with many things. Actually, I didn't know much about it. It's just an inside story. We may agree or disagree. I have many points of disagreement with him. But the book he has written, I think only 2-3 ambassadors. In Kathmandu Post, 10 days ago, I have written a piece about this book. If you read it, you can get it. Sriman Narayan wrote Nepal and India, an exercise in open diplomacy. And he just talks about the role of the ambassador, how he tried to persuade the king, Mahendra, to change the situation. Because the Nepal government was going to hand over a certain portion of the East West Highway to Chinese government. But at the time, the then ambassador quietly persuaded the king not to do that because it is a threat to us. Because he raised the issue of security threat. And King Mahendra suddenly changed the situation and the East West Highway was handed over to India from Janakpur, Dhalkebar to Mechi. It things happen, you know, the rulers will try to understand if we try to pursue things in a diplomatic, in a quiet way. That's why sometimes quiet diplomacy works. and not this emotional diplomacy, I call it. Emotion and diplomacy cannot go together. Here in this country, emotion matters much. Politicians raise the issue, they have their own agenda, and suddenly people buy it. That is how they have tried to spoil the relationship for the last so many years, decades and decades, historically speaking. Particularly after 1950, this thing has happened. And today also, the same thing. If some politicians try to, they don't have the agenda, they try to pick up the story and they sell it out to the people. And it becomes, you know, then hue and cry. That emotionalism works a lot in India-Nepal relationship. This is, as you say, psychological part of it. The title of the book, I was reading this morning, I have read several times. He gave me book in Delhi, I was there in connection with my son's operation. In the hospital, then I was there for 10, 12 days. Then I read the book within 2 days and I was also invited to take part in that discussion. Of course, I could not do it. Suddenly there was a disconnection of everything and I could not continue it. Then I wrote a piece in Kathmandu Post after I came back. The title of the book, if you read it, Kathmandu Dilemma, of course, dilemma in New Delhi also. How to negotiate with Nepal? Because China is emerging as a power, other activities are being done, and that is also a dilemma in New Delhi. And particularly in Nepal, I don't think that we have India policy. No government has ever tried to understand India-Nepal relations properly, actually. We don't have India policy. We talk about 1950 treaty, abrogation, sometimes amendment, sometimes this, sometimes that. But what are the alternatives? What will be the implications for India-Nepal relationship? We never try to evaluate it. We have to see the implications also. Can we manage? Can we negotiate? Because I don't think that we have that capacity now. Because these days, no governments, particularly after revolution 1925, after 1990, no government has given any thought to Indo-Nepal relations, how to take it ahead. That's why I don't consider myself as a supporter of Nepal's policy, because we don't have any policy. India has policy because it tried to stick to the same old British pattern with certain amendments. And Ambassador Ray has also suggested, and he is very sympathetic actually. And he wants to moderate the situation and suggest that if Bhutan model, whether Bhutan model can be suitable for Nepal also, then I don't think that, because our situation and Bhutanese situations are very similar, because we are much ahead of Bhutan in many respects, dynamics, politician, parties, groups, you know, so many lobbies, so many original thinking, that the traditional thinking, 1950 TT and so. I call it a strong dose of securitism. In that treaty, there is a strong dose of security, and we want to moderate it. And he has suggested Bhutanese model. We have to think over it. We can consider it. This is one part. And the title of the book, at the subtitle, if you link it the book, there is a good narrative. Very 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 simple, very good. And he has given all inside the story. And tried this morning. I was again reading the epilogue. Epilogue part, he has suggested so many suggestions. If you read the epilogue, after he wrote the book, then he thought something should be added. Then he added that. And you see a number of suggestions for improving India-Nepal relations. That is a very positive aspect of the book. That's why he has come to the conclusion that so many issues have been raised, and he is very sympathetic about development, hydropower, and he has tried to correct. I don't know if it is a correction or not. I'm not an insider. About the Maoist insurgency and India's role during the Maoist insurgency. He said here very clearly that no, we never supported the Maoist. President Ji is here, he was the Maoist leader. And we never supported the Maoist, but we wanted to bring them together, bring them to the mainstream politics. But we wanted to, he has word the word, we wanted to degrade and destroy the Maoist at that time. But here in Nepal, many people say, oh, Maoists were trained in India, in Dehradun, and many people have seen those camps also, and he has just rejected those kinds of wild arguments. And he has tried to put things in perspective about the Maoist role. Maoist, how the Maoists were being, yes, during the negotiation, naturally, any government will help to stabilize the situation, to improve the situation. And that is quite natural. And 12-point program, of course, they were sympathetic. India wanted to bring the Maoists to the mainstream politics. That is quite natural. What is wrong with that? You know, that's why so many things have been put in this book, and I think it is a good book, and it has given many inside stories, his own personal things. Many people do not know Dhan Parthapani, Bhanera Aaja Bihanai Padhirahe Thiyo, haina? Testai, testo kuraharu cha kasari garna sakinchha bhanera alternatives haru pani dinubhayeko thiyo. Aba tyo pani part euta cha. अब म झापाली भएँ, होल ओपन बोर्डर छ सबै, माथि इलामदेखि लगेर चाहिँ यहाँसम्म हाम्रो बोर्डर हो. महाकाली साइड काली रिभरले चाहिँ त्यहाँभन्दा भएको छ क्या, त्यो बोर्डर त्यहाँ फिक्स छ. त्यहाँ घटना हुन्छ या हङ्गामा हुन्छ, अब लोकल लेभलमा खालि इन्डिया गभर्मेन्टले त्यो टेकअप किन गरेन भन्ने कुरा चाहिँ त्यो चाहिँ कन्सर्नको कुरा हो. एकजना मान्छे मर्यो जुन त्यो पानीमा झरेर, एउटा त्यो खालको छ. अर्को बोर्डरको कुरा चाहिँ अब म चाहिँ के भने, हामीले बोर्डरको बारेमा किताब पनि लेखेका छौँ. बिपी फाउन्डेसनले उहाँ एम्बेसडर हुनुहुन्थ्यो, उहाँले नै हामीलाई चाहिँ धेरै इन्करेज गरेर, हामीले पटनामा, दिल्लीमा, लखनऊमा धेरै ठाउँ हामीले उहाँ पनि यहाँ पनि यो कुराहरू उठाएका थियौँ. गर्दाखेरि बोर्डरको कुरा चाहिँ के भने, बोर्डर मेजिस्ट्रेट लेभलमा मेकानिजम बनाएको छ, त्योहरूको मिटिङै हुँदैन. अब एउटा सानो कुरा हुन्छ अनि अब काठमाडौँमा हो हल्ला, डेमोन्स्ट्रेसन, नाराबाजी, इन्डियन एम्बेसीमा प्रोटेस्ट सुरु हुन्छ. त्यस कारणले त्यो अर्कै खालको रिलेसनसिप छ. अब यो कुरा चाहिँ त्यो चाहिँ मलाई पोसिबल लाग्दैन, कसरी चाहिँ हामी रेगुलेट गर्छौँ. अब जस्तो अहिले चाहिँ उनीहरूले चाहिँ हामीले चाहिँ आर्म पुलिस फोर्स राखेका छौँ, उनीहरूले पनि यस के अरे सशस्त्र बलको कुरा छ, त्यसलाई अलिकति बढाउने, रेगुलेट गराउने, अलिक कन्ट्रोल गर्ने कुरा हुनसक्छ. त्यो बोर्डर क्लोज गर्ने पक्षमा त अब त्यति मलाई सम्भव मलाई लाग्दैन. त्यो कसैले सोचेको छ भने त्यो सम्भव पनि हुँदैन जस्तो लाग्छ मलाई.
थ्याङ्क्यु सर. मलाई अघिदेखि सरले भन्दै म सबै नेपाली बसेका छौँ, अङ्ग्रेजी नै बोलिरहेछौँ. गुरु भनेको त्यसैले हो नि, तिमीले सबै गुरु सिकाउने भने यहाँ त्यही हो. मैले त्यसैले अघि नेपाल भारतको सम्बन्ध भविष्यमा कस्तो हुने, पास्टमा भएको कुराहरू र कसरी यसलाई रिसेटिङ गर्ने भन्ने कुरा छँदैछ. साथसाथै मिस्टर रञ्जित राय जुन बेला जोइन्ट सेक्रेटरी हुनुहुन्थ्यो मिनिस्ट्री अफ एक्सटर्नल एफेयर्समा, नेपाल र भुटान हेर्नुहुन्थ्यो, त्यो बेलामा हाम्रो शान्ति प्रक्रिया सुरु भएको छ. शान्ति प्रक्रियाको दुईजना अत्यन्त महत्त्वपूर्ण व्यक्तित्वहरू नेपालका पूर्व प्रधानमन्त्री स्वर्गीय विद्याप्रसाद कोइराला र वर्तमान के अरे भने पूर्व प्रधानमन्त्री पुष्पकमल दाहाल प्रचण्डजी हुनुहुन्छ, र उहाँले नै यो पिस प्रोसेस सुरु गरेको. यो किताबमा पिस प्रोसेसको बारेमा लामो कुराहरू छन्. एउटा कुरा भर्खरै भारत सरले भन्नुभयो, र मैले राजदूतसँग र अरू पनि इन्डियाका राजदूतहरूसँग गएर धेरैचोटि कुरा हुँदाखेरि उहाँहरूको के थियो भने, सुरुमा हामीले माओवादीलाई त समाप्तै पार्नुपर्छ किनभने हामी कहाँ नै धेरै ठुलो थ्रेट छ, त्यसैले यसलाई तर यसले कता पिसफुल सेटलमेन्ट हुन सक्छ कि भन्ने चाहिँ उहाँको किताबमा बडा राम्रो के छ भने, कि भारतकै पोलिसी मेकरहरूको बिचमा दुईवटा ओपिनियन रहेछ, कि यसलाई ल्यान्डिङ गराउने कि यसलाई डिस्ट्रोय गरेर जाने भन्दाखेरि, त्यो दुईवटा कुरो बडा महत्त्वपूर्ण कुरा त्यो बारेमा छ. र शान्ति प्रक्रियाका एकजना सिग्नेटरी प्रधानमन्त्री र नेपालमा, अर्को उहाँको किताबमा अत्यन्त महत्त्वपूर्ण कुरो सोसल इन्क्लुजनको बारेमा छ, अर्थात् नेपालमा रहेका पछाडि पारिएका समुदायहरू, दलित, मधेसी, जनजाति, महिलाहरू र अन्य जुन अपाङ्गता भएका व्यक्तिहरू यी सबैलाई कसरी समावेशी र गराउन सकिन्छ, र यसले नेपालको कन्फ्लिक्टलाई कसरी रिजोल्युसन गर्न सक्छ भन्ने चाहिँ पनि ठुलो च्याप्टर छ. र त्यसमा उदाहरण भारतको भारत में सुरू में संविधान ड्राफ्ट करने बेला में जो कि इन्क्लूसिव पॉलिसी पॉलिटिक्स र ब्यूरोक्रेसी दुईटा में लियो अभी भारत में इवन प्राइवेट सेक्टर में इन्क्लूजन को कुरा उठिरहेको छ त्यो बारेमा बड़ा डिटेल में अब यो सारा प्रक्रिया को वहाँ को व्यक्तिगत बारे में किताब में यो बारे में त्यसैले म आदरणीय प्रधानमंत्री पुष्पकमल दाहाल प्रचण्डजीले आफ्नो विचार राखिदिनलाई अनुरोध गर्दछु।
आफ्नो प्रकारको विशिष्ट इभेन्ट भनौँ कार्यक्रमका आयोजक कर्णजी, किताबका लेखक पूर्व राजदूत रञ्जित रेजी, प्राध्यापक डाक्टर लोकराज बरालजी र यहाँ आज मञ्चमा रहनुभएका विशिष्ट व्यक्तित्वहरू र उपस्थित महिला तथा सज्जनवृन्द, म सबभन्दा पहिला त नेपाल भारत सम्बन्ध जस्तो अत्यन्त जटिल, अत्यन्त मौलिक र विशिष्ट प्रकृतिको बहुआयामिक सम्बन्धबारे किताब लेख्ने र त्यसको बारेमा एउटा बहस सृष्टि गर्ने आँट गर्नुभएकोमा, साहस गर्नुभएकोमा रञ्जित रेलाई म विशेष रूपले धन्यवाद भन्न चाहन्छु, किनकि उहाँले भने जस्तै यो निकै कम्प्लेक्स सम्बन्ध पनि छ नेपाल भारतको, निकै युनिक र हिस्टोरिकल पनि छ, जसको तुलनामा तुलना अन्यत्र पाइँदैन। त्यस्तो विषयमा राजदूत भएर लामो समय नेपाल बसेको व्यक्तिबाट किताब चलाइनु आफैमा यो एउटा च्यालेन्जिङ काम पनि हो र यो एउटा अगाडि जानको लागि एउटा ठुलो अपर्चुनिटी क्रिएट गर्ने, जोखिम उठाउने काम पनि हो भन्ने म ठान्छु। त्यसर्थमा यो हामी सबैको निम्ति विचार उत्तेजक पनि छ र अगाडि जानको निम्ति यसले थुप्रै सजेसनहरू पनि राखेको छ। त्यसकारण यो महत्त्वपूर्ण सामग्री तयार भएको मैले महसुस गरेको छु र उहाँले बडो चाहिँ आफ्नो तर्फबाट पुरै इमान्दारीता अपनाउने कोसिस गरेको मैले फिल गरेँ। यो किताब हुन त मैले अझ डिटेलमा भित्र पसेर पुरै अध्ययन गर्नुपर्ने महसुस गरेको छु, त्यो भ्याएको त छैन, तर बर्ड्स आई भ्यू जस्तो मैले सरर पढ्दाखेरि उहाँले आफ्नो ठाउँबाट इमान्दारीता साथ तथ्यहरूलाई अगाडि राख्ने र नेपाल भारत सम्बन्धका अगाडिका चुनौती, समस्या र सम्भावनाहरूको खोजी गर्ने जमर्को चाहिँ उहाँले गर्नुभएको छ। दोस्रो, उहाँले सुरुदेखि इन्डियन पर्सपेक्टिभमा लेखिएको छ भन्ने कुरा बडो सहज ढङ्गले भन्नुभएको छ। उहाँ नेपालमा भारतको लागि राजदूत हुनुको नाताले, भारतको एउटा परिपक्व डिप्लोम्याट पनि हुनुको नाताले उहाँले नेपाली पर्सपेक्टिभमा त यो किताब लेख्न सक्नुहुन्थेन, उहाँले भारतीय पर्सपेक्टिभमा नै लेख्नु पर्थ्यो। उहाँले भारतीय पर्सपेक्टिभलाई अगाडि राखेर नै लेख्नु भएको छ। त्यसकारण हामीहरूले अध्ययन गर्दा हाम्रो नेपाली पर्सपेक्टिभ के हुनसक्छ भन्ने कुरा त्यहाँ भित्रबाट खोज्न सक्नुपर्छ भन्ने मैले महसुस गरेँ। त्यो त रञ्जितजीले भारतीय पर्सपेक्टिभमा लेख्नु स्वाभाविक छ, हामीहरूले नेपाली पर्सपेक्टिभमा त्यसलाई कसरी बुझ्न सकिएला त? त्यहाँ भित्रपट्टि राखेका तथ्याङ्कहरूलाई हामीले कसरी विश्लेषण गर्यो भने नेपाली पर्सपेक्टिभ तयार हुन सक्छ भन्ने कुराको खोजी गर्न पनि यो पुस्तकले हामी सबैलाई त्यतातिर सोच्न प्रेरित गरेको छ भन्ने पनि मैले ठानेको छु। उहाँले नेपाल भारत संबंध का सन्दर्भ में साना देखि ठूला कुराहरू आफूले थाहा पाएसम्म का विषयहरूलाई अगाडि राख्दै अरु इतिहास को भूगोल को संस्कृति को अर्थतंत्र का यावत विषयहरू पूर्वाधारसँग संबंधित विकाससँग संबंधित यावत विषयहरूको भित्रपट्टिबाट उहाँले नेपाली मनोविज्ञान को चर्चा पनि गर्नु भएको छ। उहाँले सानो मलाई त हुन त उहाँसँग मेरो धेरै पटक उहाँ राजदूत हुँदा धेरै प्रसंगमा हाम्रा छलफलहरू हुने गर्थे र त्यति बेला उहाँले मलाई भनेका धेरै कुराहरू मैले किताबमा भेटे। मसँग कुरा हुँदाखेरि उहाँ जस्तो उदाहरणको लागि दशरथ रङ्गशालामा फुटबल म्याच हेरेको सायद भोलिपल्टै हो उहाँको र मेरो कुरा भएको थियो। उहाँले त्यो फुटबल म्याचमा दर्शकहरूको इमोसन त्यहाँ उनीहरूको बडी ल्याङ्ग्वेज उनीहरूले सिटी लगाउने ताली बजाउने सबै सबै कुराहरूबाट यो नेपाली हो के मनोविज्ञान हो भन्ने कुराको उहाँले बडो गहिरो गरी चिन्ताको साथ मसँग चर्चा गर्नुभएको थियो। मैले हेरेँ किताबमा पनि उहाँले त्यस्ता धेरै कुराहरू राख्नुभएको छ। ऋतिक रोशन प्रकरण भनौँ उसले भनेको हो या होइन भन्ने कुराको खोजी राम्रोसँग गर्नुभन्दा पनि यो भनेकै हो भन्ने विश्वास तुरुन्तै गर्ने र यहाँ जुलुसहरू निक्लिने मुठभेडहरू हुने मान्छे मारिने सम्मका घटनाहरू भएका छन्। त्यसलाई पनि उहाँले नेपाली मनोविज्ञान नेपालको राष्ट्रवाद के हो भन्ने ढङ्गले त्यसलाई त्यस्ता अरू थुप्रै कुराहरूलाई व्याख्या गर्नुभएको छ। म अहिले यो बारेमा अरू कमेन्ट म केही पनि गर्न चाहन्न। उहाँले अगाडि बढेर चाहिँ समस्या समाधान गर्नुपर्छ भन्नेतिर उहाँको उद्दतीकरण छ त्यो सकारात्मक छ। तर यस्तो नेपाली मनोविज्ञान बन्नुमा इतिहासदेखि वर्तमानसम्म भारतको स्थिति के हो भन्ने कुराको जति विश्लेषण हुनुपर्थ्यो त्यति छैन भन्ने मैले ठाने। किनभने नेपाल एउटा सानो भूपरिवेष्टित देश हो। यो इतिहासदेखि वर्तमानसम्म कहिल्यै कसैको अधीनमा भएन। एउटा स्वतन्त्र राष्ट्रको रूपमा नै रहिराख्यो। विविध कारण छन् त्यसमा। यहाँको भूगोल पनि एउटा कारण होला, यहाँको जातीय बनोट पनि एउटा कारण होला, यहाँको संस्कृति पनि कारण होला, थुप्रै थुप्रै होलान्, त्यसको विश्लेषण गर्न सकिन्छ। तर नेपाल एउटा सानो राष्ट्र हुनुको नाताले र इतिहास देख्ने स्वतन्त्र राष्ट्र हुनुको नाताले पैदा भएको मनोविज्ञान सानो हुँदा कहीँ न कहीँ त्यहाँ असुरक्षाको भावना आउने खतरा कतै हामी ठुलाबाट हेपिएका त छैनौँ या हामी ठुलाको इन्ट्रेस्ट चाहिँ हामी माथि कुनै न कुनै रूपले लागिएको अथवा लादिएको त छैन भन्ने भावना हुनु सर्वथा स्वाभाविक छ। यो यहाँ मात्रै होइन विश्वभरि पनि त्यस्तो देखिने गरेको छ इतिहासभरि पनि। जे होस् नेपालको भूगोल इतिहास र संस्कृतिको कुल योगफलको रूपमा नेपाली मनोविज्ञान नेपाली राष्ट्रवादको एउटा विशिष्ट स्वरूप बनेको छ भने भारत झन्डै 200 वर्षसम्म अङ्ग्रेजको अधीनमा हुँदा कस्तो मनोविज्ञान बनेको छ भन्ने कुराको नेरेटिभ पनि हामी अगाडि जानको लागि गरिनु पर्दछ। त्यसले के मनोविज्ञान बनायो, अङ्ग्रेज मनोविज्ञान भनेको के हो, अङ्ग्रेज बस्दा त्यसले पारेको सकारात्मक प्रभाव र त्यसले पारेको अर्को नकारात्मक प्रभाव के हुन् भन्ने कुराको आजको सन्दर्भमा फेरि एकचोटि त्यसको विश्लेषण त्यसको समीक्षा र अहिले 21 शताब्दीको लागि हामी अगाडि जाने र हाम्रो मित्रता जुन बहुआयामिक छ मौलिक छ छुटाउनै सकिने खालको छैन त्यसलाई सुदृढ गर्ने उपायहरूको खोजी गर्नुपर्छ भन्ने मलाई लाग्छ। यसको निम्ति उहाँले डिबेट उठाइदिनु भएको छ। जे भए पनि भारतीय बुद्धिजीवी सर्कलमा पनि र नेपाली बुद्धिजीवी सर्कलमा पनि यो किताबले एउटा डिबेट ल्याउँछ नै र ल्याउनु पनि पर्छ र त्यसले नेपाल भारत सम्बन्धलाई बलियो बनाउनको निम्ति भूमिका खेल्नु पर्दछ। हामी सबै त्यसमा सचेत हुनुपर्दछ भन्ने ठान्छु म। पहिलो कुरा मैले उहाँको पहिलो च्याप्टरमा जे लेख्नु भएको छ त्यसको सन्दर्भमा मैले त्यस्तो महसुस गरेँ। दोस्रो, उहाँले माओइस्ट इन्सर्जेन्सीको बारेमा पनि लामै व्याख्या गर्नुभएको छ र त्यो कसरी सुरु भयो, अहिले शान्तिमा रूपान्तरणको क्रम कसरी अगाडि बढ्यो भन्ने बारेमा पनि उहाँले बडो स्पष्ट रूपमा राख्ने कोसिस गर्नुभएको छ। म उहाँलाई यस सन्दर्भमा विशेष धन्यवाद केमा दिन चाहन्छु भने नेपालमा एउटा ठुलो भ्रम थियो र अझै पनि त्यो भ्रम छ, माओवादीहरू भारतद्वारा उत्पादन गरिएको हो, उनीहरूलाई तालिम भारतले नै दिएको हो र उनीहरूका हात हतियारहरू पनि सबै भारतले नै प्रदान गरेको हो भन्ने निकै ठुलो स्टोरी, एउटा इलुजन, एउटा कन्फ्युजन नेपाली समाजमा एउटा वर्गले, एउटा तबकाले पार्न धेरै बल गर्यो। अझै पनि म त्यो प्रयास कुनै न कुनै कोणबाट जारी भएको देख्छु। यो किताबमा रञ्जितजीले त्यो बिल्कुल होइन भन्ने कुरा बडो प्रमाणित र आधिकारिक रूपमा व्याख्या गर्नुभएको छ, म निकै खुसी भएँ। त्यो भ्रम, त्यो इलुजन चाहिँ अब यो किताबले चिरदिन्छ। भारत त लास्टैसम्म पनि माओवादीलाई दबाएरै सिद्ध्याउनु पर्छ भन्ने चाहन्थ्यो, आतंककारी नै ठान्थ्यो, कुनै सहयोग गरेको होइन, बरु भारतमा नै थुप्रै माओवादी नेताहरू गिरफ्तार गरिएकै हुन् र तिनलाई नेपाल डिपोर्ट गरिएकै हो भन्ने कुरा र अन्तिममा शान्ति प्रक्रियाको या बाह्र बुँदे समझदारीको तयारी हुँदै गर्दा पनि भारतीय नेतृत्व पङ्क्तिमा दुई खालका धार थिए। एउटा, माओवादीलाई कुनै हालतमा पिसमा ल्याउन हुँदैन, उनीहरूलाई दबाएर नै सिद्ध्याउनु पर्छ भन्ने पनि थियो, र एउटा होइन उनीहरूलाई
त्यो कुरा पनि रञ्जितजीले बडो स्पष्ट रूपमा किताबमा राख्नु भएको छ। मलाई बडो सन्तोष भएको छ। हो, हामीले भारत त्यति बेला हामी भूमिका, तर हामी नेपालीहरूसँगै बसेका थियौँ, नेपाली मजदुरहरूसँग, त्यहाँका श्रमजीवीहरूसँग भूमिगतै बसेका थियौँ। त्यहाँ जाँदा, मिटिङ गर्दा, त्यहाँ भारत सरकारको या त्यहाँको सत्ता पक्षको कहीँ कतै कुनै किसिमको हामीलाई सहयोग प्रोत्साहन केही पनि थिएन। यो कुरालाई यो किताबले चाहिँ राम्रोसँग उदिन दिएको छ र सच्चाइ के हो भन्ने कुरा राखिदिएको छ। म नेपालको बौद्धिक समुदायलाई विशेष रूपले यो विषयमा विचार गर्न र यो किताबलाई गहिरो गरी अध्ययन गर्न र अरू केही लाग्छ भने त्यो बारेमा डिबेट उठाउन पनि म अनुरोध गर्न चाहन्छु। र फेरि साथसाथै पछिल्लो चरणमा यो कुरा पनि सत्य हो, स्वयं रञ्जितजी जोइन्ट सेक्रेटरी भएको बेलामा उहाँले त्यहाँ प्रश्नसँग लेख्नु भएको छ, राजा सँगै भएका कुराहरूदेखि माओवादी नेताहरूसँग भएका कुराहरूसम्म विभिन्न राजनीतिक दलहरूसँग भएका प्रसङ्गहरू ल्याउँदै यो नेपालको युद्धको समस्यालाई शान्तिको तरिकाद्वारा, पोलिटिकल सेटलमेन्टद्वारा, कम्प्रोमाइजद्वारा हल गर्नुपर्छ भन्ने धार हाबी हुँदै गएर मैले बुझ्दाखेरि रञ्जितजी त्यही धारको एउटा प्रतिनिधि हो। नेपालमा अगाडि बढेर धर्मनिरपेक्षता होस्, गणतन्त्र होस्, सङ्घीयता होस्, समावेशी होस्, समानुपातिक होस्, त्यो नेपाली जनताले फैसला गर्ने कुरा हो।
नेपाली जनताको फैसलालाई हामीले सम्मान गर्नुपर्छ भन्ने धारको नै उहाँले प्रतिनिधित्व गर्नुहुन्थ्यो र उहाँको तागतले मैले बुझेसम्म उहाँको तागतले भ्याएसम्म सकारात्मक वातावरण बनाउन उहाँले भूमिका खेलेको म सम्झिन्छु। त्यस अर्थमा पनि यो पुस्तक धेरै महत्त्वपूर्ण छ र हुनसक्छ यो पुस्तकमा माओइस्ट इन्सर्जेन्सीको बारेमा गरिएको विश्लेषण या नेपालको परिवर्तनको बारेमा गरिएको विश्लेषण कतिपयलाई मन नपर्न सक्छ, जसलाई सङ्घीय लोकतान्त्रिक गणतन्त्र मन परेको छैन या पर्दैन, समावेशी समानुपातिक यो देशका उत्पीडित वर्ग जाति क्षेत्र लिङ्ग समुदाय सबै राज्य सत्तामा समावेशी र समानुपातिक प्रतिनिधित्व मन परेको छैन, दलितहरू हजारौँको सङ्ख्यामा लोकल गभर्मेन्टदेखि प्रोभिन्सियल र सङ्घीय गभर्मेन्टसम्म आएको मन परेको छैन, महिलाहरू 33% प्रतिनिधित्व हुनुपर्छ भन्ने मन परेको छैन, उनीहरूलाई यो किताब त्यति रुचिकर नलाग्नु त्यति राम्रो नलाग्न सक्छ उनीहरूले, किनभने उहाँले एउटा प्रवृत्तिलाई कहीँ न कहीँ यो किताबभरि एक्सपोज गर्न नियतले खोजेको भन्दा पनि उहाँको विश्लेषणले एउटा प्रवृत्ति जो हामी चाहिँ नेपालमा भन्दा प्रतिगामी भन्ने गरेका छौँ, अलि परम्परावादी ट्रेडिसनल भनौँ या त्यस्तो सोच राख्नेलाई यो फरवर्ड लुकिङ खालको सजेसन दिने प्रकृतिको कुरा मन नपर्न सक्छ। तर मेरो बुझाइमा हाम्रो नेपालको यो परिवर्तनलाई सकारात्मक ढङ्गले बुझ्ने हेर्ने आम नेपालीहरूले यसलाई सकारात्मक ढङ्गले नै हेर्छन् भन्ने मैले ठानेको छु। त्यस अर्थमा पनि रञ्जितजीले एउटा राम्रो चाहिँ काम गर्नुभएकै मैले ठाने, त्यो काम पनि महत्त्वपूर्ण नै छ। तेस्रो कुरा मैले भन्न चाहने, चौथो अब यो विषय ठुलो विषय छ भन्ने मलाई लाग्छ, माओवादीलाई मेन स्ट्रिममा ल्याइयो, यो डे वानदेखि नेपालमा यो डिबेटको विषय छ, माओवादीलाई मेन स्ट्रिममा ल्याइएको हो कि माओवादीले नयाँ मेन स्ट्रिम तयार गरेको हो, बाह्रबन्दे समझदारी विस्तृत शान्ति सम्झौता गिरिजा प्रसाद कोइराला स्वर्गीय गिरिजा प्रसाद कोइराला र मेरो बिचमा सम्झौता भएर सुरु भएको स्ट्रिम नयाँ स्ट्रिम हो कि राजा सहितको हिजोको सिस्टम मेन स्ट्रिम हो, कुन चाहिँ मेन स्ट्रिममा कसले लगेको कुरा गरिएको हो, को विजेता हो को पराजित हो राजनैतिक रूपले र फौजी रूपले, यो हाम्रो बडो विशिष्ट खालको छ, यो पनि कम्प्लेक्स छ, सजिलो छैन, तर एकझरी मानिसहरूले सजिलै भनिदिने गरेका छन् हामीले माओवादीलाई ठिक गरेर ल्याइयौँ, हामीले भन्ने गरेका छौँ अन्तर्राष्ट्रिय राष्ट्रिय क्षेत्रीय सबै परिस्थिति हेर्दा योभन्दा अगाडि युद्ध लानु देशको हितमा हुँदैन जनताको हितमा हुँदैन, यही उपयुक्त समय छ कम्प्रोमाइज गर्ने, डेमोक्रेटिक पोलिटिकल पार्टीहरूसँग कम्प्रोमाइज गर्ने, जो आफूलाई डेमोक्रेसीका हिमायती भनेर राजतन्त्रद्वारा भनौँ हामी सामन्ती तन्त्र निरङ्कुश तन्त्रद्वारा प्रताडित भएका शक्तिहरू छन् तिनीहरूसँग हातेमालो गरेर गणतन्त्रसम्म देशलाई लान सकिने परिस्थिति पैदा भएको छ, यो परिस्थितिलाई हामीले सदुपयोग गर्न सक्नुपर्छ, योभन्दा बढी युद्ध तन्कायो भने त्यो युद्ध सञ्चालकहरूलाई नै प्रतिउत्पादक हुन्छ, पुरा दुनियाकै चाहे त्यो एसियामा भएका विभिन्न खाले सशस्त्र विद्रोहका कुरा हो, फिलिपिन्सदेखि टर्कीदेखि इरानदेखि विभिन्न देशका या ल्याटिन अमेरिकी देशहरूमा साउथ अमेरिकन देशहरूमा भएका सशस्त्र युद्धहरू हुन्, पेरुदेखि कोलम्बियादेखि सबै देशका या विभिन्न ठाउँमा भएका राष्ट्रिय आन्दोलनहरू हुन् श्रीलङ्का भारतमै पनि यी सबै अनुभवहरूको निचोड निकालेर लिडरसिप अब शान्तिमा जानुपर्छ र शान्तिको सम्भावनाको खोजी गर्नुपर्छ र त्यो शान्ति राजनीतिक परिवर्तन सहितको शान्ति हुनुपर्छ भन्ने निर्णय माओवादीले गरेको हुनाले भनेर मैले भने भने त्यसरी पो शान्ति भएको हो त हामीलाई परास्त गरिएको हुनाले हामीले सरेन्डर गरेको त होइन भनेर मैले भने भने त्यो कति तथ्यसङ्गत हुन्छ या हुँदैन बडो विचारणीय छ यो प्रश्न कसले हो सरेन्डर गरेको कसले हो यो चेन्जको वाहकको रूपमा भूमिका खेलेको कसले हो भन्ने कुरा पनि हामी भित्रै बहस अझै टुङ्गिएको छैन अझै पनि बहस चलिराखेकै म देख्छु र यो सन्दर्भमा रञ्जितजीको यो किताबले तथ्यको एउटा पक्षलाई चाहिँ उहाँको पर्सपेक्टिभबाट भारतीय पर्सपेक्टिभबाट भनौँ या उहाँको विश्लेषणको आधारमा उहाँले सिन्सियरली नै राखेको ठाने मैले तर त्यो पूर्ण हो कि होइन भन्ने कुरा हामीले जज गर्नै पर्छ त्यो कति पूर्ण छ या छैन भन्ने कुरा जे भए पनि भएको कुरा के हो भने परिवर्तन हो राजतन्त्रबाट गणतन्त्रमा हामी गएकै हो एकात्मकताबाट सङ्घात्मकतामा हामी गएकै हो समावेशी समानुपातिकतामा हामी गएकै हो धर्मनिरपेक्षतामा हामी गएकै हो संविधान सभामा हामी गएकै हो र यी सबै राजनीतिक एजेन्डाहरू नेपालको पछिल्लो कन्टेस्टमा माओवादीकै एजेन्डा हुन् कसैलाई मन परे पनि कसैलाई मन नपरे पनि ती एजेन्डाहरू माओवादीले नै उठाएको र स्थापित गरेको हो र विशाल जनमत त्यसको पक्षमा छ भन्ने कुरा 64 निर्वाचनमा व्यक्त भएको हो माओवादीले धान्न सकेन त्यहाँ माओवादीका आफ्नै सीमा आफ्नै कमजोरीहरू पनि त्यहाँ रहेका छन् तर तथ्य यही नै हो यो तथ्यबाट हेर्दा हामी कसैले जितेको र कसैले हारेको भन्दा हामीले नेपाली समाजको राजनैतिक रूपान्तरणलाई अगाडि राखेर कम्प्रोमाइज गरेको हो र यो कम्प्रोमाइज राष्ट्रको हितमा थियो छ जनताको हितमा थियो र छ र यो नेपाल भारत सम्बन्धको हितमा थियो र छ भनेर हामीले साबित गर्न सक्नुपर्दछ न कि एउटालाई अपमानित र ह्युमिलिएट गरेर गर्न खोज्ने एउटा छ नि मैले हिजो आज तपाईँहरू हामी सबैले हेरिराखेकै छौँ नि एक थरी ब्युरोक्रियाटहरू हिजोका माओवादी सखात नभएसम्म यो देशले सुख पाउँदैन भनेर वक्तव्य दिएको हेरेको छु मैले अहिले पनि 17,000 मान्छे मारेर आएको भन्ने आरोप लगाउने पूर्व प्रधानमन्त्री बोलिराख्नु भएकै छ भने यसको सत्य तथ्य के हो भन्ने कुराको आधिकारिक र प्रामाणिक विश्लेषण अझै पनि जरुरी छ भन्ने म ठान्छु यस सन्दर्भमा रञ्जितजीको किताबले हामी सबैलाई उत्प्रेरित गरेको छ फेरि एकचोटि सच्चाइलाई राम्रोसँग स्थापित गरियोस् भन्ने कुरा चाहिँ लाई यसले उत्प्रेरित गरेको छ भन्ने मैले ठानेको छु जे भए पनि एउटा के कुरा सत्य हो भने सबैको सहयोग नभइकन त यो शान्ति सम्झौता भएको होइन त्यसमा हुन त कतिपय शक्ति केन्द्रहरू यो शान्ति सम्झौता हुनै नपाओस् भनेर अन्तिम समयसम्म नै बल गरेको पनि हामीलाई थाहा छ मलाई लाग्छ रञ्जितजीलाई पनि थाहा छ त्यो कुरा तर पनि नेपालका राजनीतिक शक्तिहरू लोकतान्त्रिक राजनीतिक शक्तिहरू र हाम्रा छिमेकीहरू चाहिँ यो प्रक्रिया अगाडि आओस् भन्ने सहयोगको भावना नभएको भए पनि हामीले माओवादीले मात्रै चाहेर यही ठाउँमा आउन सकिँदैन त्यो कुरा पनि म सिन्सियरली राख्न चाहन्छु त्यो माओवादीले मात्रै चाहेर या त्यति बेलाका सात राजनीतिक दलले मात्रै चाहेर पनि यो सबै सहज ढङ्गले सम्पन्न हुन सक्दैन हाम्रा छिमेकीहरूको अझ त्यसमा भारतको सकारात्मक धारणा हुनै पर्थ्यो भयो त्यसकारण हामी अहिले यहाँ छौँ र यस्तो बहस हामी गरिराखेका छौँ म इन्सर्जेन्सीको सन्दर्भमा यति मात्रै कुरा सबैको ध्यान आकर्षण गर्न चाहन्छु र मैले अहिले अन्तर्राष्ट्रिय समुदायका धेरै व्यक्तित्वहरूसँग भनेको छु हामीले जे हासिल गर्यौँ नेपालमा शान्ति हासिल गरेका छौँ हामीले बडो युनिक छ त्यो हतियार व्यवस्थापन सेना समायोजन डेमोक्रेटिक इलेक्सनमा सहभागिता शान्तिपूर्ण प्रतिस्पर्धा पटक पटक त्यसमा चाहिँ माओवादीले आफूलाई पास गरेको छ आफू विवादित भए पनि त्यो आफ्नो कमिटमेन्ट जो शान्ति सम्झौतामा जे कमिटमेन्ट गरिएको हो त्यो कमिटमेन्टबाट हस्ताक्षरकर्ताको हैसियतले म कहीँ कतै दायाँ बायाँ भएको छैन बरु ठुलो सेक्रिफाइस आफैले उठाउँदै यो प्रक्रियालाई सफल पार्न मैले आफ्नो ठाउँबाट कन्ट्रिब्युट गरेको छु भन्ने मेरो छ र मैले आजकल धेरैसँग भन्ने गरेको छु तर यसको रिकग्निसन चाहिँ जसरी हुनु पर्थ्यो इन्टरनेसनल कम्युनिटीबाट या देशभित्रैकै पनि हाम्रो बौद्धिक जगतले या राज्यका सबै संयन्त्रहरूले या हाम्रा छिमेकीहरूले पनि जसरी रिकग्नाइज गर्नुपर्ने होइन भन्ने मेरो थम्याइ छ यो राम्रो यसले राम्रो सङ्केत गरेको छैन दुनियाँका सबै शान्ति सम्झौती प्रक्रियाहरू हेऱ्यो भने साउथ अफ्रिकादेखि कोलम्बियादेखि थुप्रै देशका साथीहरू हेऱ्यो भने हाम्रो शान्ति प्रक्रिया मौलिक छ सफल छ छोटै अवधिमा ठुल्ठुला परिवर्तनलाई सम्भव तुल्याएको छ तर यो यस्तो हो भनेर आधिकारिक रूपमा रिकग्नाइज गर्न शक्ति केन्द्रहरू तयार भइरहेका छैन कहीँ न कहीँ हिचकिचाहट छ त्यो चाहिँ हुन हुँदैन थियो भन्ने लाग्छ मलाई र हामी नेपालीहरूले यदि हामी यो परिवर्तनलाई सकारात्मक ढङ्गले हेरिराखेका छौँ यो समावेशिता समानुपातिकता गणतन्त्र सबै सबै भने हामीले यसमा गर्वको साथ यसलाई स्थापित गर्न सबैले भूमिका खेल्नुपर्छ र मात्रै नेपालमा दिगो शान्ति र विकासको निम्ति एउटा राम्रो आधार बन्न सक्छ मैले यो बारेमा यति कुरा राख्न चाहेँ र अन्तिममा चाहिँ सजेसनहरू उहाँले राख्नुभएको छ ती फरवर्ड लुकिङ नै छन् नेपाल भारत सम्बन्धका आयामहरू धेरै छन् भन्ने कुरा हामी सबैले महसुस गर्छौँ नेपाल भारत सम्बन्धलाई सुदृढ गरेर मात्रै नेपालमा राजनीतिक स्थायित्व र विकासको वातावरण बन्न सक्छ भन्ने कुरामा पनि हामी कसैमा दुविधा छैन तर त्यसो गर्दा हामीले आजको 21औं शताब्दीको विकासको स्थिति र त्यसले पैदा गरेको मनोविज्ञान नेपालका कन्सर्नहरू के हुन् चिन्ताहरू के हुन् र किन हुन् भारतको चिन्ताहरू के हुन् र किन हुन् र दुईटा सार्वभौम सत्ता सम्पन्न उहाँले त्यो कुरा पनि लेख्नु भएको छ मोदीजीले जसरी आएर संविधान सभामा बोल्नुभयो र नेपाली नेताहरूदेखि सांसद सबैले पटक पटक लामो लामो ताली बजाए जति बेला भारतीय प्रधानमन्त्री नरेन्द्र मोदीजीले नेपाल एउटा स्वतन्त्र सार्वभौम सत्ता सम्पन्न राष्ट्र हो भन्दाखेरि ताली त्यो त यसो हेर्दा त खिताली लाग्नु पर्ने कुरा त होइन नेपाल त हुँदै हो नि सार्वभौम सत्ता सम्पन्न स्वतन्त्र राष्ट्रै हो नि उहिले पनि थियो अहिले पनि छ भोलि नै हुन्छ तर हामीले ताली लगाइयो बडो उत्तेजित भइयो खुसी भइयो यो भित्र चाहिँ उहाँले अलिकति खोतल्नु खोज्नु भएको छ के हो यो हुँदै हो नि भनेर पनि उहाँले नै भन्नुभएको छ यो कुराको हिसाब चाहिँ अलि राम्रोसँग भारतले गर्नुपर्छ भन्ने लाग्छ मलाई भारतीय नेतृत्वले भारतीय बुद्धिजीवीहरूले नेपालीहरू बुद्ध नेपालमा जन्मेका हुन् भन्दा खुसी हुन् जन्मेकै हुन् नि त्यत्रो धेरै उत्पात त हुनुपर्ने कुरो होइन तर चाहिँ नेपालमै जन्मेका हुन् भन्दा मात्रै बल्ल खुसी भइन्छ कसैले अर्को कुनै भाषा प्रयोग गर्यो बुद्धले बुद्धत्व प्राप्त गरेको त भारतमा हो नि भन्यो भने त्यति मिठो लाग्दैन कारण जन्मे त नेपालमै हो नि भन्न मन लाग्छ प्राप्त गरेको त भारतमै हो नि हुन त बोध गयादेखि कुशीनगरदेखि सबै ठाउँहरू सारनाथ सबै हो नि तथ्य त त्यो पनि हो यो मनोविज्ञानको विश्लेषण हामी दुबईले र मुख्यतः भारतले नै बढी गर्नुपर्छ भन्ने ठान्छु म भारतले मोदीजीले आएर सार्वसत्ता हो तिमीहरू स्वतन्त्र हो भन्दा ताली बजाउनेहरूलाई त ताली बजाएको बजाइ गर्ने बनाइदिनु पर्यो नि सधैँ ताली बजाउने बनाइदिनु पर्यो फेरि ठुलो राष्ट्र कहिलेकाहीँ के हुन्छ भने ठुलो राष्ट्रको जमिन पनि धेरै छ जनसङ्ख्या पनि धेरै छ त्यसो भएको हुनाले अब ठुलो राष्ट्रले सानो राष्ट्रलाई थोरै थोरै जमिन सानोको उतापट्टि पस्यो भने पनि खासै फरक पर्दैन सानो ठुलोको के अरे ठुलोको चाहिँ यता पस्यो भने त हालत खराब हुन्छ नि सानोको त यो सेन्सिटिभिटीलाई पनि भारतीय नेतृत्वले भारतीय बुद्धिजीवीहरूले गहिरो गरी समीक्षा गर्नुपर्दछ भन्ने मलाई लाग्छ त्यसो गर्दा त हाम्रो सम्बन्ध चाहे सिमानाका अहिले जे जे हामीले पहिलादेखि भनेका छौँ समस्याहरू छन् ती संवादको तरिकाद्वारा उदार मन लिएर चाहिँ समाधान गर्न नसकिने कुरा छैन मलाई लाग्छ भन्जेनजीको यो किताबले सबै जटिल समस्याहरू पनि समाधान गर्न सकिन्छ भने क्लू पनि दिएको छ किताबले भन्ने मैले महसुस गरेँ केही क्लू दिएको छ कसरी समाधान गर्न सकिन्छ भन्ने कुरा तिनलाई समातेर हामी अगाडि जान सकिन्छ जानु पनि पर्छ भन्ने मलाई लाग्छ हामी मिल्नुको विकल्प छैन इतिहासले भूगोलले संस्कृतिले अर्थतन्त्रले जनता जनताको यति व्यापक सम्बन्धले रोटीबेटी भनेर एउटा च्याप्टरै लेख्नु भएको छ रोटीबेटीको सबै सम्बन्धले हामीहरू मिलेर एकअर्काको कन्सर्नहरूलाई ध्यान दिएर सकारात्मक र रचनात्मक ढङ्गले समाधान गर्दै अगाडि जानुपर्छ पछाडि फर्केर होइन अगाडि बढेर मात्रै समस्याको दीर्घकालीन समाधान गर्न सकिन्छ र यो मान्यतालाई यो पुस्तकले कहीँ न कहीँ प्रेरित गर्न खोजेको छ विदेश नीतिको हकमा यो कुरा साँचो हो कि कुनै पनि देशको विदेश नीति भनेको त्यो देशको आन्तरिक नीतिको विस्तारित रूप नै हो र हुन्छ नम्बर एक नम्बर दुई कूटनैतिक सम्बन्ध र विदेश नीतिको चाहिँ मुटु मन हुँदैन दिमाग मात्रै हुन्छ उसले हेर्ने दिमाग मुटुले मनले इमोसनले हुँदैन यो विवेकले हुन्छ र विवेकमा आधारित भएरै त्यो सम्बन्धलाई हामीले परिभाषित गर्नुपर्ने हुन्छ र दुई देशको सम्बन्धलाई परिभाषित गर्ने कुरा आइडियोलोजी होइन सिस्टम पनि होइन भारतमा कुन सिस्टम छ नेपालमा कुन सिस्टम छ भन्ने कुराले दुई देशको सम्बन्धलाई निर्धारण गर्दै जुनसुकै होस् यदि नेपालको इन्ट्रेस्ट नेपालको नेसनल इन्ट्रेस्टमा भारतले बाधा होइन सहयोग पुर्याएको छ भने भारतसँग हाम्रो राम्रो मित्रता हुन्छ नेपालमा जुनसुकै सिस्टम होस् नेपालको सिस्टमले भारतको नेसनल इन्ट्रेस्टलाई बाधा पुर्याएको छैन बरु त्योसँग सहयोगी हुन मद्दत गरेको छ भने नेपालसँग भारतको पनि राम्रो सम्बन्ध हुन्छ यो कुरा दुनियाँमा देखिएकै छैन नि सिस्टमले के काम गरिरहेछ साउदी अरबमा के सिस्टम छ अमेरिकामा के सिस्टम छ साउदी र अमेरिकाको के सम्बन्ध छ हामीलाई थाहा छ हिजो भारतमा के सिस्टम थियो युएसएसआरमा सोभियत सङ्घमा के सिस्टम थियो तर इन्दिरा गान्धी र चाहिँ सोभियत सङ्घको 20 वर्ष सन्धि के थियो हामीलाई थाहा छ सिस्टम मिलेको भनेको अमेरिका र भारतको त्यो बेलामा के अवस्था थियो नमिलेकाहरूको चाहिँ मित्रता त्यस्तो थियो केले गर्दा भयो त्यो भन्दा नेसनल इन्ट्रेस्ट एकअर्काको नेसनल इन्ट्रेस्ट सर्भ गर्यो एकअर्काले मद्दत गर्यो भने त्यहीँनिर चाहिँ तपाईँका सम्बन्धहरू सुदृढ भएर जान्छ हामी भारत र नेपालको सम्बन्धलाई जो युनिक भन्छौँ, स्पेसिफिक खालको छ भन्छौँ, यो दुनियाँमा अन्तर नभेटिने खालको छ भन्छौँ, हामीले भनी पनि राखेका छौँ। त्यस कारण नेपालको नेसनल इन्ट्रेस्ट र भारतको नेसनल इन्ट्रेस्टलाई एक अर्काले सम्मान गर्ने, सहयोग गर्ने प्रक्रियाको सुरुवात गरियो भने दुनियाँको कुनै पनि ताकतले हाम्रो सम्बन्ध सुदृढ हुन रोक्न सक्दैन। हामी सबै त्यतैतिर लागौँ। मलाई लाग्छ रञ्जितजीको किताबले एउटा नयाँ डिबेट सहित नयाँ सम्बन्ध विकासमा मद्दत गर्नेछ भन्ने विश्वास सहित म बिदा हुन्छु। धन्यवाद। अहिले
एउटा प्रश्न, प्रधानमन्त्री एउटा के भने उहाँको किताब सँगसँगै हाम्रो यो लामो बोर्डर ओपन छ सम्बन्धको, यो ओपन बोर्डरमा धेरै समस्याहरू पनि देखिन्छ र समाधानका उपायहरू पनि छन्, यहाँले कसरी देख्नु भएको छ?
अब हाम्रो मैले भने हामी सबैले मान्छौँ कि इतिहासदेखि विकसित भएको सम्बन्ध हो हाम्रो, र वर्तमानमा त्यसको त्यसलाई सुदृढ गर्दै भविष्यको निम्ति बाटो खोज्नुपर्छ हामीले। हाम्रो ओपन बोर्डर नै हाम्रो समस्या, ओपन बोर्डरलाई
रेगुलेट गर्ने, इन्ट्रेस्टलाई ओपन बोर्डर हुँदा हुँदै पनि सर्भ गर्ने उपायको खोजी गर्ने कुरा मुख्य हो भन्ने म ठान्छु। त्यसो गर्न सकिन्छ, त्यो डिबेट सुरु भएको पनि छ भन्ने मलाई लाग्छ। लगाइएका आरोपहरूदेखि लिएर धेरै कुराहरू उहाँले नेपाल भारत सम्बन्धको बोर्डरको धेरै कुराहरू, मैले एम्बेसडर रञ्जित रायको किताब पढ्दाखेरि मलाई दुई तिनवटा बडा घतलाग्दो कुराहरू, मेरो घर वीरगन्ज हो, म 7-8 क्लाससम्म पढ्दाखेरि यो दुईवटा देश हो भन्ने मलाई थाहै थिएन। मेरो मामा घर इन्डियामा छ र यो एउटा अर्कै खालको, मतलब पछि पछि आउँदाखेरि त्यहाँ बोर्डर रहेछ, पुलिस रहेछ भन्ने बिस्तारै बुझ्दै गएको हो। कल्चर कसरी डेभलप भयो भन्ने चाहिँ उहाँले प्रश्न गर्नुभएको छ, नेसनलिजमको बारेमा प्रश्न गर्नुभएको छ। मैले आई कोट प्रताप भानु मेहता, पोलिटिकल साइन्टिस्ट, 4-5 वर्ष अगाडि उहाँ काठमाडौँ युनिभर्सिटीको कन्भोकेसनमा चिफ गेस्ट हुनुहुन्थ्यो र प्रचण्डजी त्यहाँ चिफ गेस्ट र उहाँ चिफ स्पिकर हुनुहुन्थ्यो। उहाँले बोल्दाखेरि एउटा बडा महत्त्वपूर्ण कुरो भन्नुभएको थियो कि नेसनलिजम इज अ पोइजन एन्ड बिङ युज्ड बाई द अथोरिटेरियन लिडर टु एक्सप्लोइट द सेन्टिमेन्ट अफ द कमन मासेज फर देयर पोलिटिकल एन्ड अथोरिटेरियन गेन भनेर छ। आई डु बिलिभ अन दिस। हामी हाम्रा कतिपय कुराहरू नि, एउटा नेपालीमा बिहान म र अजयजी कुरा गर्दै थियौँ, अजय भद्र खनाल हामीसँग यहाँ सँगै काम गर्छौँ, कि हाम्रो बानी गजबको रहेछ, मोही माग्ने र ढुङ्रो लुकाउने। हामी आफै गएर इन्डियन एम्बेसीमा हामीलाई यो गरिदिनुहोस् न भनेर भन्न जान्छौँ, फेरि बाहिर आएर भारतले माइक्रो म्यानेजमेन्ट गर्यो पनि भन्छौँ। एम्बेसडरले जुन घटना लेख्नु भएको छ उहाँसँग मेरो त्यो बारेमा त्यही बेलामा पनि कुरो भएको थियो, र उहाँले एउटा अर्को घटना गृहमन्त्रीको एपोइन्टमेन्ट सम्बन्धी कुरा गर्नुभएको छ। मलाई उहाँले एकचोटि के भन्नुभयो भने मलाई अहिले पनि याद छ, हायातमा एउटा प्रोग्राम थियो आइसिसिआर इन्डियन काउन्सिल अफ कल्चरल रिलेसन्सको, उहाँले बोलेकै शब्दमा भनिदिरहेछु, हाम्रो यहाँ कोही गृहमन्त्री नै बन्न चाहता, आपके यहाँ सब लोग गृहमन्त्री क्यों बन्न चाहते हैं भनेर उहाँले मलाई सोध्नुभयो। मलाई पनि बडा वास्तवमा हो, मलाई याद छ कि राजनाथ सिंहजीलाई प्राइम मिनिस्टर मोदीले रिक्वेस्ट गरेर होम मिनिस्टर बनाउनु भएको थियो, प्राइम मिनिस्टर डाक्टर मनमोहन सिंहले पी चिदम्बरमलाई फाइनेन्सबाट रिक्वेस्ट गरेर होम मिनिस्टर बनिदिनुहोस् भन्ने चाहिँ उहाँले रिक्वेस्ट गर्नुभएको थियो। हामी कहाँ किन यसरी हुन्छ भन्ने चाहिँ लाग्छ। हामीले हाम्रा रिलेसनहरूलाई, हाम्रो नेसनलिजमलाई हामी आफ्नै पर्सपेक्टिभमा किन व्याख्या गर्न सक्दैनौँ? सानो सानो कुरो हुँदाखेरि हामी कसरी यो भारतले गरिदियो भन्ने पनि भन्छौँ। म एउटा घटना यहाँ कोट गर्छु, एकजना त्यहाँ मेरो ससुराली गाउँ एक्ज्याक्ट सप्तरीको त्यो कुनौली बेलीतिर मेरो ससुराली र कुनौली भारतमा पर्छ, त्यहाँ एउटा घटना घट्यो अनि त्यो पानीको झगडा भयो, बाढी आएको थियो दुवैतिर, त्यहाँ नर्मल झगडा हो। मेरो वाइफले के भन्छ भने सालमा 5 झगडा हुन्छ अनि त्यो चाहिँ दुईटा गाउँमा पनि झगडा हुन्छ, नेपाल भित्र पनि हुन्छ, भारतमा पनि हुन्छ, र त्यो हाम्रो राष्ट्रवादको विषय बन्यो। एकजनाले गएर त्यसलाई टोपी सोपी लगाइदिनु भयो अनि त्यसपछि त्यो विषय पानीको झगडा चाहिँ हाम्रो भारतले यसरी हामीलाई पेल्यो भनेर भन्नु। हि कल्ड मी एन्ड आस्क वेयर इज दिस प्लेस, कहाँ छ यो, मलाई बताउनुहोस् त यो के भएको हो भनेर। अनि मैले सबै बताएँ यस्तो यस्तो हो भनेर भन्दाखेरि उहाँहरूलाई थाहै पनि थिएन। यस्तै घटनाहरू कतिपय कुराहरू हाम्रो आफ्नै क्यारेक्टरमा छन्। हामी आफैले पनि सोच्नुपर्ने, प्रोफेसर बरालले बडा राम्रो भन्नुभयो, हाम्रो इन्डिया पोलिसी के हो त। हामीले जसरी इन्डियाले भनेको छ नि नेबरहुड फर्स्टको पोलिसी आएछ, त्यहाँको फरेन एफेयर्समा कमिटीमा डिस्कस हुन्छ, हाम्रो के हो त इन्डिया पोलिसी, त्यो हामीसँग छैन। र हामी ती विषयहरूलाई राष्ट्रवादको विषय बनाउँछौँ जुन विषय हाम्रो आफ्नै सम्बन्धहरूको बिचमा त्यसले अप्ठ्यारो स्थिति बनाउँछ। सानसानो कुराहरूबाट ऋतिक रोशन काण्ड, म 3 दिन आफ्नो घरमा थुनिएर बस्नु परेको थियो, मलाई आश्चर्य लागेको थियो। किनभने त्यो मेरो छोरीलाई 2 क्लासमा पढ्थ्यो, उसलाई थाहा पनि थिएन ऊ मधेस योगी पहाडी हो भने चाहिँ, उसलाई स्कुलका साथीहरूले तिमीहरू नौ घर स्कुलमा भनेर भने। अब यो ऋतिक रोशनले एउटा भन्दैमा देश टुक्रिन्छ भने, ऋतिक रोशनले भन्दैमा हाम्रो देश भारतले खाइदिन्छ भने, यो कस्तो सोच हो भने चाहिँ। यही कुरो मैले सिकेर उसको सन्दर्भमा भनेको थिएँ, म कोट गर्न चाहन्छु आदरणीय पूर्व सभामुख दमानाथ ढुङ्गानालाई, उहाँले के भन्नुभयो भने सिके राउतले एकचोटि बोल्ने बित्तिकै हाम्रो देश टुक्रिन्छ, सिके राउतले देश बनाएको हो भने चाहिँ, एउटा कसैले बनाउँदै एउटा सङ्गठन बनाउँदैमा देश टुक्रिन्छ भने चाहिँ, यो हाम्रो दिमागबाट साइकोलोजिकल जुन ब्यागेज छ हाम्रो, यो साइकोलोजिकल इमोसनल ब्यागेजलाई बडा राम्रो भन्नुभयो प्रचण्डजीले कि हामी उसमा फरेन पोलिसी र डिप्लोमेसीमा यो इमोसन केही काम गर्दैन। हामी फरेन पोलिसी र डिप्लोमेसी पनि इमोसनबाट गाइडेड भएर गरिरहेको जस्तो लाग्छ। हामीले हाम्रा नेसनलिजम एकतिर हामी इन्डियालाई हामीले यो गर्दै त्यो गर्दै भन्न जाने, अर्कोतिर के भन्यो भने त्यो के अरे भने यो इन्डियाले किन गर्यो भने वी इन्भाइटिङ माइक्रो म्यानेजमेन्ट, इट्स भेरी क्लियर मेनिफेस्टेसन इन हिज बुक। हामी आफै मेन गर्यो भने हामीले गर्दैन त्यस्तो गर्दै भन्छ, अनि फेरि बाहिर आएर त्यो अर्को कुरा गर्ने। यो हाम्रो प्रवृत्ति हो, यो दिस इज नट, यो चाहिँ भएन भन्छ उनीहरू। उहाँको किताब पढ्दाखेरि मैले जियो पोलिटिक्सको राम्रो व्याख्या गर्नुभएको छ, नेपालमा चाइनिज प्रेजेन्स बढेको, चाइनाको इन्फ्लुएन्स बढेको, यहाँ मात्र होइन, नेपालमा मात्र होइन, यो त अल ओभर द वर्ल्ड भइरहेछ, साउथ इस्ट एसियामा, अस्ट्रेलियामा, अफ्रिकामा, चारैतिर कम्पिटिसन छ। साउथ एसियामा पनि चाइना र इन्डियाको कम्पिटिसन, अमेरिका र चाइनाको कम्पिटिसन, चारैतिर जियो पोलिटिक्स बढिरहेछ। यो सन्दर्भमा जुन किसिमको रिलेसनहरू एक्टिभिटिजहरू भए लास्ट 4-5 वर्षमा त्यसले चाहिँ इन्टरनेसनल कन्सर्न भएको छ। तर के जहिले पनि हामी सन्तुलनको कुरा गर्छौँ, भारत र नेपालको, भारत र के अरे नेपाल र चिनको बिचमा, यो हेर्दाखेरि म उहाँको कतिपय कुरासँग सहमत के छु भने फ्युचरमा के त भारत र नेपालको जस्तै इकोनोमिक रिलेसन हामी नेपाल र चाइनाको हुन सक्छ कि सक्दैन, भारत र नेपालको जस्तै कनेक्टिभिटी नेपाल र चाइनाको हुन सक्छ कि सक्दैन, यो हुन सक्दैन, त्यो विभिन्न कारणले हुन सक्दैन। हामीले एउटा रिसर्च गरेका छौँ जसमा नेपालसँगको ट्रेड चाइनाको कुनै प्रायोरिटीमै छैन, कहीँ केहीमा छैन चाइनाको। लास्ट 1.5 इयर्सदेखि 2 बोर्डर अलमोस्ट क्लोज छन्, तर उसको इकोनोमीलाई केही फरक पार्दैन, हाम्रो इकोनोमीलाई फरक पारिरहेछ। त्यो कनेक्टिभिटी उसलाई भन्दा पनि हामीलाई चाहेको हो, र त्यहाँको चिनसँगको हाम्रो सम्बन्ध ट्रेडमा छैन, चिनको टोटल ट्रेडमा नेपालसँगको ट्रेड कहीँ केहीमा अर्थै राख्दैन त्यो। तर नेपाल र भारतको बिचमा, नेपाल र भारतको ट्रेड या नेपालको ट्रेड इन्डियासँग होस् या इन्डियाको ट्रेड नेपालसँग, त्यो मिनिङफुल छ, कनेक्टिभिटी मिनिङफुल छ। हामीले हेर्दाखेरि के देखिरहेछौँ भने हामीले ट्रान्जिट ट्रिटी गरेका छौँ चिनसँग, तर आज 4-5 वर्ष भइसक्यो, प्रोटोकल पनि साइन भएको, तर खोइ केही पनि भएको छैन त। हामीले त इन्डियाको अल्टरनेटिभ खोजेको हो नि त त्यो ट्रिटी बोल्दाखेरि, प्राइम मिनिस्टर खड्ग प्रसाद ओलीले यो हिस्टोरिकल डिपार्चर हो र यसले चाहिँ नेपालको ट्रेड र इकोनोमीमा ठुलो खोइ त भएको त, एउटा कन्टेनर पनि हामीले इम्पोर्ट गर्न सकेका छैनौँ. हाम्रो व्यापारीहरूले भएको प्रोटोकलले इम्पोर्ट हुन पनि सक्दैन. मैले बोले होइन, मलाई पूर्व वाणिज्य दुईजना सचिवहरूले भनेको कुरो म भन्दैछु यहाँ चाहिँ, उहाँहरूले भनेको चाहिँ. त्यसैले यसलाई यसरी हामीले कम्पेयर गर्दाखेरि त्यो चाहिँ अलिक गाह्रो होला कि भनेर मलाई लागेको छ. त्यसैले हामी हाम्रो एउटा कुरो जहिले पनि राजदूत यहीँ हुँदाखेरि पनि मैले भन्ने गरेका थिएँ कि एउटा कुरो कि दिल्ली र काठमाडौँले बिरगन्ज रक्सौल या नक्सलबाडी र के अरे काकरभिट्टा बुझ्दो रहेछ. दिल्ली र काठमाडौँको अर्कै खालको सम्बन्ध हुने रहेछ. काठमाडौँमा बस्नेहरूले बोर्डर बन्द गर्नुपर्छ, वाल उठाइदिनुपर्छ भन्छन्. तर यही कुरो बिरगन्जका मान्छे पनि काठमाडौँ जतिकै बनाफाइट नेपाली नेसनल उसलाई सोध्ने र रक्सौलको मान्छेले सोध्यो भने त अर्कै भाषा पो बोल्छन् त. यो नेरेटिभ यसलाई यहाँ देखिएका कतिपय म अघिदेखि बोर्डरको कुराहरू सोधिरहेको थिएँ. हामीसँग पूर्व परराष्ट्र मन्त्री र एमिनेन्ट पर्सन ग्रुपका चेयरपर्सन डाक्टर भेषबहादुर थापा पनि हुनुहुन्छ. यहाँ हामी कहाँ डिस्कसनमा हामी रहेछौँ के हो त बोर्डरलाई कसरी म्यानेज गर्ने त. हामीसँग यी क्वेसनहरू पनि छन्, यस्ता कुराहरू छन्. यो चाहिँ के अरे भने हामी इन्डिया अहिले पूर्व प्रधानमन्त्रीजीले भन्नुभयो इन्डियाको अल्टरनेटिभ कोही हुन सक्दैन. यो वास्तवमा हुँदैन. धार्मिक सांस्कृतिक पारिवारिक रोटी बेटी धेरै सम्बन्धहरू छन्. त्यसै गरी हाम्रो चिनसँगको जुन सम्बन्ध हो त्यो पनि आफैमा युनिक छ होइन. हाम्रो विभिन्न कारणहरूले गर्दा हामी पनि कतिपय कुराहरू सेयर गर्छौँ. त्यहाँका टिबेटसँग हाम्रो प्राचीनतम सम्बन्धहरू बुद्धिज्मका लगायत धेरै कुराहरू छन्. चिन हाम्रो असल मित्र नै हो होइन. तर हाम्रा केही जुन समस्याहरू चिनसँग होस् चाहे भारतसँग होस् त्यसको म के देख्छु भने यो सडकभन्दा पनि डिप्लोमेसी कूटनीति र हाम्रा लिडरसिपहरूले त्यसलाई चाहिँ मेच्योर ढङ्गले गऱ्यो भने सायद यसको समाधान निस्किन सक्छ. म एम्बेसडर रञ्जितलाई एउटा कुरो उहाँले किताबमा लेख्नु भएको छ, म एउटा खालि जस्ट आई वुड लाइक टु नो द्याट द रोल अफ इन्टरनेसनल कम्युनिटी एज यु मेन्सन्ड इन युर बुक वाट वाज इन द ड्युरिङ द पिस प्रोसेस लाइक द सुपर पावर एन्ड अदर रिजनल पावर इन्क्लुडिङ चाइना. वी हेभ रिमेम्बर देन वेन प्राइम मिनिस्टर कोइराला भिजिटेड दिल्ली देयर आर लट अफ international community gathered at the Delhi. That is what we have learned, but it is not clearly mentioned. Can you tell little bit about that incident, the what kind of atmosphere actually, because of the American was another stand and then European has another stand, there was conflicting stand during that time. So how the India managed the international support for this peace process? That was a very important question for the people like us. As you are a practitioner and insider both, and writer now, and as you said, you are a free citizen now of India, so you can tell more one thing. Second thing I would like to know that as you mentioned, there are a lot of prescription in your book. But what I see that as Prime Minister Prachand said that we are a small country. And we have many things when we see that such a giant country, economy, trade, our trade is so imbalanced with India. So at the moment, we are little bit fear of the India giantness and all. So how can Nepal respond to India's concern and how India can respond to Nepal's concern? If you mention some of the things and many questions raised by the other panelists, it will be better. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. Just to respond to these two questions. So, you know, there were a lot of differences within the international community on how to deal with this Maoist insurgency. I remember the Americans, they were very negative. And you know, these are terrorists and we, you know, basically the state has to use force to neutralize them. So this was the American point of view, and I think, you know, at that time the ambassador here was very strong proponent of this policy. India's view had, you know, gradually evolved, and especially after February, the events of February 2005, So we had a steady engagement with the Americans and the British, and of course, you know, EU and others. And there was this constant dialogue process going on, trying to explain, you know, how we saw the situation. And I think eventually, you know, the US government and the State Department, I think, went along with this view. Of course, the Americans had certain other very specific issues, you know, about terrorist activities and so on also. So it is only through an exchange of views, you know, had we not been exchanging views amongst the various countries, then each country would have been working at cross purposes, and you know, there would have been a lot of crossfires and confusion. On the economic side, you see, you know, there are many relationships that are asymmetrical, you know, small country, large neighbor relationships. And this is a structural issue, and obviously this impacts on the relationship. And there are all kinds of fears and you know, perceptions and misperceptions. So I personally, you know, and the small country can look at its big neighbor as a threat or as an opportunity. You know, you can, you know, you can look at a neighbor as a huge market, you know, for your produce, whatever you produce. Or you can look at it as a threat. So, you know, we should remain separate, otherwise, you know, they will just, we will be swamped. So I think, you know, the only way to overcome this, I think, is by strengthening economic engagement. So the smaller neighbor must feel that it is benefiting tangibly from the relationship, you know, in economic terms. And that is why I have stressed this economic engagement between our countries. So if our neighbors feel that they are also benefiting from the growth of the Indian economy, the buoyancy of the Indian economy, then I think this will be a very good basis, and a lot of the fears and misperceptions will tend to get removed. So, you know, that is why I think this economic engagement is so critical.
Thank you, Mr. Pradhan.
Honorable Chief Guest, Excellencies, Delegates, representatives from foreign and domestic institutions, distinguished speakers, professors and scholars, guests, ladies and gentlemen. This wraps up our afternoon. On behalf of Center for Social Inclusion and Federalism, thank you all for making time in your busy schedules to join us here this afternoon. It's been our pleasure to host this event, and I wish you all a pleasant evening ahead. Kindly join us for high tea, where we can commence with the informal discussion. Thank you once again.